welcome to ASI. What a blessing it is to be here. I love ASI because it gives us a chance to meet other people who are on the front lines and just worship the Lord together in fellowship.
You know, Yvonne, I love ASI so much. I'm not even supposed to be here this year.
No.
I wear this badge that says no talking, but I couldn't help it. I had to show up and be a part of this great ASI International Convention right here in Phoenix, Arizona. God is leading, He's guiding, He's blessing. We know you're gonna be blessed. Stay with us throughout today. And we're gonna join the singing, then we're gonna have some great speaking, music, and testimony. So thank you again, once again, for joining us, ASI, Phoenix, Arizona.
And no more talking.
No more talking.
You sound wonderful this morning, and we want to make a special welcome to all those who have come to worship with us this morning from the Phoenix area. Our next song this morning is number 619, Lead On, O King Eternal. We are leading, we're marching forward. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Let us sing this beautiful hymn, Lead On, O King Eternal.
Thank you.
needed. Thank you very much.
Welcome, everyone, to ASI at Worship. That's a welcome to the 3ABN audience. That's a welcome to our live audience here in Phoenix. You know, at our convention, we hear a lot of wonderful testimonies. We hear heavenly music. We meet and make friends. We learn about ideas for ministry. But the high point of ASI is worship. And just as we gather here today to worship together, our Redeemer and our Creator, one day we will stand on the sea of glass before the throne of God. And we will not be alone, because with us before God then will be the seraphim, the cherubim, and 10,000 times 10,000 angels praising and adoring God. These angels are in a holy alliance with us here in this world to work unitedly for the salvation of souls. And they, like us, will rejoice for all eternity for every decision that is ever made for Christ through our witnessing in the marketplace.
That's right, Brother Norm. Happy Sabbath, everyone. How many of you believe that Jesus is coming soon? And that we are all called and chosen and committed to taking this gospel to the world? You know, there is nothing more special, Norm, than to be at an ASI convention.
Amen.
To be with people who are all committed to that task of helping save souls so that they will be with us on that sea of glass. You know, sometimes people ask, what is the benefit of being a part of ASI? What is the benefit of joining ASI? Well, brothers and sisters, this morning, the benefit is being able to be equipped to share the gospel with the world. Amen. To be a part of a like-minded family of believers that are totally sold out to take the three angels' messages in this generation to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. So we want to invite you this morning. There are some here. Some of you would qualify to be ASI members, business owners, professionals, or ministry leaders. We want to invite you to find out more about becoming a member of ASI. We have a slide we're going to show on the screen at this time, and you can find it in your program guide as well. We want you to text this number to find out more information about being a part of ASI. You can text JOIN, you can text ASI, you can text HAPPY SABBATH. Just text something to 301-844-6035, and we will get you information about becoming a member of ASI. But Norm, whether you're a member of ASI or not, all of us are one family. We are all united in our calling, united in the fact that God has chosen us and given us the strength to commit to taking the three angels' messages to the world in this generation.
One of the ways that we do it, especially in worship, is through the foolishness of preaching. Who would want to sit and listen to someone talk for a half hour or an hour? Except when the Holy Spirit is present, wonderful changes occur in our hearts and in our minds. And the chosen speaker of this hour is John Bradshaw. John is the speaker director of It Is Written Television. And we pray that the Spirit of the Most High God will use him today to be a channel of blessing for us.
Our choral call to worship this morning invites everyone to participate in singing. I invite you to stand, everyone. Please stand and join us as we sing our choral to worship, We Will Glorify.
Oh,
We're thankful to be here today. Let's bow our heads and thank our Heavenly Father for his blessings. Dear Father, as we're coming to worship you this morning, we want to thank you especially for all this time together. It's been a wonderful week. And as we wrap up our networking together and learning of other ways to work with sharing Jesus in the marketplace, I pray that you'll guide us to those special appointments that we need. Someone who will encourage us, someone whom we can encourage, someone we can mentor, someone who will mentor us. I pray that we go away from this special service with a blessing in our hearts. We want to share Jesus everywhere. And if every Seventh-day Adventist, business, and professional person were sharing Jesus, how soon you could come. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Be seated.
We have the privilege to sing one more time. Invite you to sing with us number 21, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Please be
standing. The very heart of Africa lies the nation of Rwanda. Despite a darkened past, a new light is beginning to dawn over this land of a thousand hills as a bold new initiative of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is being implemented in unprecedented ways. This is the story of total member involvement. Thank you.
in a country ravaged by pain a few years ago, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is bringing hope.
This is one of the most exciting events that I've attended.
East Africa is excited about TMI.
Here in Rwanda, we're witnessing something that's unprecedented in the Adventist Church.
In this whole country, people feel that God is out for something huge.
This is total member involvement. Thousand years ago, Jesus launched a program, actually it's the Great Commission, and we all know it, Matthew 28, go and preach and teach and baptize and disciple. And because of that Great Commission, we're all excited and interested here in Rwanda about total member involvement.
We have seen church members take off with this incredible idea of total member involvement.
They have gotten so involved themselves. They have given cows away, they've given goats away, they've given sheep away.
Literature distribution, Bible studies, health outreach, community services.
They made banners, scarves, t-shirts, all kinds of things to promote TMI.
The people who are members here take the time to invite their friends. The church leaders follow up with the people to make sure they're ready to be baptized. So it's really a team effort.
Not only are the Rwandans involved in doing TMI, but the General Conference staff is excited and interested to be involved here and model what we are talking about back in Silver Springs, Maryland.
The Lord wants to use everyone, pastors, lay people, everyone in this great effort.
Church members have been energized as they are taking ASI New Beginning sermons and preaching, and they're excited about reaching friends and neighbors for Jesus and bringing them to some of the TMI meetings.
For a long time, the work has been in the hands of the pastors, and the lay people have been spectating by and large. But now, everybody has a role to play. Everybody has somebody they can reach.
Every church member now has understood that wherever he is, he'll be trying to reach one and bring one.
There are over 2,200 evangelistic sites here in this beautiful but small country of Rwanda. And we're only two of those 2,000 plus sites. A few of those sites have young people from the United States, people from Europe.
I am 12 years old and I preach here in Rwanda. I was so excited when I made my first call and hundreds of people came forward. It was very exciting.
This is my first time preaching, doing anything like this. It is the most fulfilling experience that I have ever had.
I rely on God, but here you really like rely on God to speak through you, to use you in any way possible, and it's limitless what he can do with a willing soul.
Before I came on this mission trip, I was feeling very cold spiritually, like, okay, is this all to Christianity? But the first night, I saw that God had a purpose on why I was there. God has really shown his love to me. I have seen that he is real because you see him moving in the hearts of other people. And when you see the changes that are happening in their lives, you can't doubt that he can do the same for you.
Every night, thousands of people are making decisions for Christ.
These wonderful people are ready to be baptized and to join this great Advent movement. What we're witnessing right here on the shores of Lake Kivu is representative of what is happening all across this country.
100,000 baptisms, the most that's ever happened in the history of the Adventist Church.
And the exciting thing is, this is only the beginning.
This program is going to continue until Jesus will come again.
This is so exciting what has happened here in Rwanda, but this is a model for the world church. We don't want it to end here. It's up to you to make it happen in your local church, your local community, your local conference.
You don't have to do some grand thing to be involved in TMI. It should be part of your everyday life.
All of us have been given opportunities, and we need to do what God has called us to do to fulfill the mission that He has given to each one of us.
What a time to be alive. What a time to be part of Total Member Involvement. God bless each one of you as you engage with heaven and the power that the Lord will give you to carry this message to the very ends of this earth.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. So nice to be here on this beautiful Sabbath morning, and we want to talk a little bit more about offerings in action. With me is our world president, Elder Ted Wilson, for the world president for the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and Dwayne McKee, who is assistant to the president for Total Member Involvement. Let me ask you first, Elder McKee, what just happened here with this video?
Unbelievable. I've been a missionary, worked in Africa since 1975, done lots of mission trips, lots of evangelism all across Africa. I've never seen anything like this. The Holy Spirit was poured out. 700,000 people were praying that God would bless, and God blessed beyond belief.
And all because of using a tool like New Beginnings.
1,850 lay people preaching New Beginnings sermons.
Praise God, it's wonderful. And then where are all of these new members gonna go to church?
Well, that's a problem. We need 1,000 brand new churches there. Pray with us that will happen soon.
Okay, we are looking forward to that. We wanna make sure that they have a church home. Thank you very much, Elder McKee. Elder Wilson, tell us, what does this mean, that a tool like New Beginnings and an initiative like the One Day Church, what does that mean for the World Church?
Debbie, before I share that in a moment, I just want to say that what happened in Rwanda was nothing short of the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we are so grateful and give all the glory to the Lord. We do also give great credit to what God did through our lay members. Amen. Total member involvement. Somehow, the church members just caught fire when they realized that this was something they were very much a part of. And that's what we're seeing now all across this globe. ASI is helping us to do that. In Rwanda specifically, the New Beginnings evangelistic series was provided to many of those sites. And in fact, I have to tell you, the 2,227 evangelistic sites, at least three-fourths of them were organized and presented by lay people. It was absolutely phenomenal. And what did they use? New Beginnings.
Amen.
New Beginnings has become a standard, a wonderful opportunity for people to preach the full message. I just want to give you a personal testimony. For the last number of years, I have been preaching evangelistic meetings, and we have them planned every year. Every time I preach these messages, I become reconverted all over again. Amen. Everything fits together. God's word is so powerful. And our lay people preaching that sense that marvelous aspect that they're part of this great Advent movement. Now, when it comes to all the people who have come in because of this effort, 100,135 people so far, and we praise God, they have to be housed. The One Day Church has been a phenomenal success in the areas where it can be constructed and placed in a very appropriate way. The One Day Church now is positioned to help those 100,000 people, many of whom are going to find homes in that wonderful opportunity of a one-day church. Amen. I just want to express enormous appreciation to ASI for what they have done, not only in presenting the word, but helping to house and preserve those who are the result of the word. Actually, those people are not just going to be preserved, they are on fire for the Lord.
Amen.
The Rwanda Union has intended now for the next year to do the same thing again. Can you imagine? Probably another 100,000, if not more. In fact, the East Central Africa Division is now planning next year for five of their unions to do the same approach where lay people are involved in total member involvement. And in 15 seconds, let me tell you, TMI, total member involvement, is not just public evangelism, it is everything that people do to prepare. Community services, literature distribution, youth, health outreach, all kinds of activities. We saw prayer efforts. Janet and Jerry Page helped to organize that initially. We had community services and ADRA working together. Everybody working together doing something for Jesus. The Lord is blessing in a miraculous way.
Thank you very much, Elder Wilson and Elder McKee,
Amen.
For sharing with us today.
Amen.
And our offerings can keep this going. The New Beginnings and the One Day Church Project are overflow recipients for our offering. So as we exceed the target that we've established, God can bless even more. With me now is Judith Mackey. Judith is the director for Binding Broken Hearts. Judith, tell us a little bit about what Binding Broken Hearts is all about.
We are, a correspondence ministry to inmates. We send them monthly Bible studies and monthly customized letters and Bibles when we have them.
And understanding that you're from Wyoming, you live
yes.
in Wyoming, and so the ministry is centered there. You've been in existence since 2009. So is it just in Wyoming that this exists?
No, that's how God surprised us. We are now writing letters, monthly letters, to 5,000 inmates in 398 facilities in 34 states.
Amen. That is remarkable. You must have a huge paid staff in order to accomplish all of this.
No. We have three or four volunteers that do this every two or three times a week or full time during the week. And our whole church gets involved once a month, stuffing envelopes, stuffing letters, and getting the letters prepared for the inmates, but no one gets paid except by the Lord.
Amen. Wow, that's really something. So you have a Bible in your hand.
I do.
Could that possibly be one that gets sent to inmates?
We do. We have this Andrews University Study Bible. It was created especially for inmates. It's only available for those who do work with inmates. And so we do send this Bible in to inmates when we have them, when they ask for one.
That's a beautiful Bible. That's high quality leather. And this is gorgeous. Maybe I'll just keep this for me.
Well, if you go into the prisons, Debbie, you're certainly welcome
to
have one.
Okay. All right, well, praise the Lord. Hopefully I won't have to get one that way. All right, so tell us about how do you fill this need? Are there a lot of requests for Bibles?
Right now we have 2,800 people who are on the list waiting for a Bible. Some of them have been waiting since last November. We've sent out over 8,000 Bibles now to inmates all over. And so as we get funds, we send Bibles.
So the project for Binding Broken Hearts this year is to fund 1,000 Bibles. So that'll take care of your list? No, it sounds it'll barely scratch the surface.
We ask ASI for 1,000 Bibles because when we put in our application, we only had 1,000 people on the waiting list. Now we have 2,800. As soon as these Bibles hit the jail, we're getting our next order the end of September. We'll start mailing in October. As soon as these Bibles hit the prisons, we will have 5 requests for every single Bible that goes in.
Now, how do you get all those requests? Do you advertise in the prisons? How do people know that you exist?
Word of mouth. We have never advertised. We offered one Bible to one lady in Missouri. She showed her cellmate, her podmate. They move from prison to prison. They see somebody having a Bible. They want one. They ask where they got them. The inmates have to ask for one themselves. Mm-hmm.
Now, you have a couple of stories, so let's listen for one about Dedrian. Is that his name?
Dedrian. I wrote to Dedrian when he was in our county jail. He was not from Wyoming. He was passing through, committed some kind of a felony, and got put in jail. So I wrote to him for about 6 months, and one Sabbath I was downstairs, and you have to understand, inmates don't usually write back, because many of them have no money. It's very expensive to write. And I was downstairs in Sabbath school one day, and this little, we have a very old church also, tiny little 4 foot tall lady, white from the top of her head to the bottom of her feet, came in, followed by this linebacker black man in his 20s. The contrast was just so amazing. And he had just gotten out of the county jail. He put himself in a situation where he was totally different from anybody in the congregation. And he came down there and he gave me a big hug. And he was so excited. And he said, I want to keep in contact, and gave me his address. Stayed for lunch and church. Didn't hear from him again. I wrote to him every month. 3 years later, I got a letter. And he said, Miss Judy, I fell away. I got in the bad crowd again. But my mama, 2 weeks ago, came in, brought the stack of letters that you have written, and said, this woman cares enough about you to write to you every month, so you need to get your life together. So he said, I'm going to move away, and I'm going to get better friends and get my life back together.
Amen, amen. Chad, tell us quickly about something that happened actually at this convention.
I went to a lunch meeting, which I was not expecting to go to. I had 5 minutes notice.
Okay. For prison ministries.
For prison ministries. I went to the lunch meeting, sat down at a table where a couple of people were there, and they got up and left. They said not because we have bad breath or anything, but who knows. And somebody else sat down there, and as we were introducing ourselves, she was so excited. She said, my husband told me you were going to be here. He is in prison. She told me his name. You have been writing to him for several years. And he said, be sure you find Judy and tell her what a blessing her letters have been to me.
Oh, what a blessing. Now, listen to this. Be sure you find Judy. She doesn't know who Judy is, how to get in contact with her, but she sits at the same table with Judy so she can deliver this message from the person you've been writing in jail. Praise God for what you're doing through Binding Broken Hearts. Thank you very much, Judy. Now coming to the podium is Chester Clark. And Chester is bringing a couple of students with him. They attend Ouachita Hills College. And we're going to hear a little bit about this ministry. Chester is a pastor in Dalton, Georgia, and sits on the board for Ouachita Hills College. And Chester, I want to ask you first. So why don't you, let's have you come close. Perfect. Okay. And tell us a little bit about Ouachita Hills and to give us some background and some context for the project that we're going to be talking about.
Sure, Debbie. Well, Ouachita Hills College exists to train young people as soul winners. And it's located in Amity, Arkansas. It offers bachelor's degrees in secondary and elementary education in religion, theology, and Christian business management, and also 2-year degrees in canvassing leadership and Bible work. And, you know, since 2003, Ouachita Hills has been graduating young people, and they are today working for God's church around the world. And like Ouachita Hills Academy, which came before, Ouachita Hills College is a work-study program. It's modeled after Madison College, which was founded under the direction of Ellen White near Nashville, Tennessee, in the early 20th century. And the major work program for Ouachita Hills College is actually literature evangelism. Now, I don't know. I'm sure there's probably quite a few people here. I'd like to just see a show of hands. Have anyone here worked as a literature evangelist, going door to door? Look at all those hands. Wow, praise the Lord. Anyone here know a family member or their family who came into a knowledge of the three angels' messages through a colporter, through literature evangelism? Once again, what an impact publishing work has had on the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And at Ouachita Hills, the students go door to door, and it's really, I'm just going to cut to the chase here since so many of you understand the publishing work. It's not a win-win situation. It's actually a win-win-win situation. And that's because the publishing work at Ouachita Hills College allows the school to operate. That's the major industry that brings in revenue for the school. It also gives the students an income-earning skill, and they earn income, which they then use to pay towards their tuition. And finally, it is also taking the three angels' messages to the world while the students are in school, which is a tremendous opportunity. I can't think of very many places that a young person can go and receive an Adventist education and earn their way through school while working to finish God's work. And so that's why we're excited about the publishing work at Ouachita Hills.
So tell us how this particular project, it seems like this project where we are providing for an expansion of the literature program there at Ouachita Hills is going to be really significant. I mean, it supports the education, the evangelism, and the colportering work.
It is significant, and it's because, you know, ASI has always, I think one of the strengths of ASI is that it seeks to leverage opportunities. And what ASI has seen is that if we can strengthen the industry of the school, if we can increase the margins, if we can make it more cost effective to get more literature out, then the work can be finished faster.
Amen.
And you know, last year, this last school year, just to give you an idea, our students sold about $700,000 worth of literature. And among those, what we call message books. Those are the Spirit of Prophecy books, the books that contain the Bible teachings for our time. Among those, there weren't 10,000 or 20,000, there weren't even 50,000, there were 82,855 message books sold last year by our students during the school year program. And it's just an opportunity for us to expand that program. And what we're doing is we're building a warehouse, and that warehouse will allow the books to be bought at a larger volume. And we also want to help, you know, other organizations, individuals or institutions, schools perhaps, who would like to develop this same type of industry, because we think that we're not territorial. We want to see lots of people doing the work. This warehouse will allow the purchase of large quantities of books and then the shipping and receiving to be able to distribute those to those who would like to be doing this type of work as well.
Excellent, excellent. So let's hear from your students. What kind of experiences might they be able to share with us?
Well, I'm going to ask Sarah first to share a story of a divine appointment that she had while she was going door-to-door and canvassing.
Well, not too long ago, I was dropped off by my canvassing leader to do a strip of businesses. And I remember as I was walking to one of my first buildings, I was praying and I said, Lord, send me to someone who is searching for truth. And one of my first buildings was a large office building, and as I walked in to my first business, I met a lady named Lynn. And as I started canvassing her and showing her my books, I could tell that she was listening but not really paying attention until she looked at my handset and she saw the Great Controversy sitting at the top of it. And when she saw the Great Controversy, her eyes got really big, and she gasped and she said, I can't believe you just walked in with that book. I have a picture of it on my iPad, and I was just about to order it, and then you walked in with it. Man. And I was really amazed, and she said, you know, I get devotionals from my church, but I get really bored with them. I want something deeper. And as we start talking, another lady walked in and joined us, and she hadn't heard of the Great Controversy, and so I started to canvass her on it. And as we started talking about Bible prophecy and end time events, the two ladies looked at each other, again with amazement, and they said, you won't believe this, but just before you walked in, we were talking about end time events and Bible prophecy. And I pulled out the rest of my prophecy set, and Lynn continues to tell me, I've been studying my Bible, trying to understand who the Antichrist is, and I've been having a hard time figuring it out, and this is just what I need. And I continue pulling out the rest of the books out of my bag, Steps to Christ, Christ Object Lessons. The second lady tells me that she leads out in Bible study groups, a youth group, and they're almost done with their series, and she didn't know what to do next. So I told her how Steps to Christ helped me as a young person to develop my own relationship with God. And to make a long story short, beautiful experience, they ended up writing out a check for 7 of our message books, Steps to Christ, Great Controversy, Christ Object Lessons, Ministry of Healing, 2 DVDs, and the Antichrist Agenda. And as she handed me the check, the first lady, Lynn, looked at me and she said, not only did you walk in with this book after our conversation, but in all the years that we've worked here together, this is only the second time that the two of us are here together. And I never come in on Wednesday. I was just here because my car had to be in the shop. And she said, God is so big, and we minimize his power in our lives so much. And we got to pray together, and it really touched me because she prayed for me first. And as she prayed that God would bless my ministry, she prayed that God would keep me from falling prey to doubt. And during that time, I had been struggling a lot with doubt. And I almost cried. And when I walked out of there, I randomly I was just so amazed by how God had answered my prayer. And for some reason, I picked up my phone and looked at it, and I had a text message from one of my teachers telling me that I had been on his mind those past few days. And about the time I walked in, he had been praying for me. And, you know, every time God does something like that for me, it just reminds me of how unworthy I am. And I knew that God had done that not just for her, but for me. And I feel like that was God's way of saying, you know, I care about the people out there, but I also love you. And even though you may be struggling with doubt, I'm still willing to use you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What a testimony of not only the impact literature ministry has on those we reach, but on those who are doing the reaching. Amen. Thank you, Sarah, for sharing that. Raul, share with us a brief story also of a divine appointment you had.
Okay. You know, something that invigorates me as I canvass is Ellen White's statement when she says that there's people wistfully looking to heaven. And I was on a very, very long street one day, and I canvassed this lady. At first she was quiet. She was just attentive, listening. And at the end of my canvas, I showed her most of my books. She just quietly said to me, you know, I was on my computer a few hours ago, and I was impressed to pray, and I asked God to lead me online to Bible books that I needed from myself and my family. And 3 hours later, you are here at my door.
Amen. Amen. So wouldn't you call that a divine appointment? And I have to just add this one thing. Raul didn't canvass this summer. He worked as a Bible worker for, actually, ASI Youth for Jesus in Beckley, West Virginia. And Raul tells me that going door-to-door canvassing helped prepare him to be an effective Bible worker. And thank you for supporting the publishing work, the literature ministry.
Thank you very much, Chester, and students. Our last offering in action segment comes from far away. And joining me here at the podium is David Cockhill. He's a development director for ICC Australia. And tell us what the focus is of that ministry and just give us some more information about it.
Before, welcome to ASI. Happy Sabbath. Glad you could make
Sabbath.
It. Spend a great day with us. I've repeated that 1,000 times at the door this morning. It's really nice to be here from Australia, but forget that for a minute. The focus of our ministry is like that, just making people feel welcome. You know, we work with, if I can paint a little picture for you, we work with some incredibly disadvantaged people, children that have been abused, children that suffer. We offer them not just hope, but we offer them something that is real, something that is tangible. And working with survivors of human trafficking is something that's incredibly rewarding. And the scope of our programs run across a few countries in Southeast Asia, which is in our neck of the woods, as we say in Australia. So it's exciting.
And how is it that these individuals come to you, or how do you find them? What happens?
Well, we don't use a GPS. Right. You know, we get referrals from the different agencies, government agencies, village chiefs, village elders. And we work with some really credible partners, one of them IJM, International Justice Mission, is a great organization out of the US that are able to give us children and young ladies who have been rescued in raids that they have executed with local law enforcement, but they don't provide any sort of care program for them, so we do the aftercare.
So how this particular project that we are supporting in this year's offering is to expand this program that will reach out and to assist individuals who are victims of sex trafficking. Tell me, how do you measure your success? Is it number of people you reach? How do you know that you're making a difference?
Sure. Well, there's a number of ways that you can measure. One is you can actually look back and do some auditing. Look back and say, well, is the business side of it working? Are we turning over a profit? Are we just consuming donor income? And so we have to be able to make a profit. We're a standalone business. It is a social enterprise. So the metrics mean that we need to create an income stream and we need to show profit. The other way is through the lives of the children and the girls that are coming through there themselves. And I've had the fortune of meeting some of these kids. They're wonderful. And a few months ago, I spent some time talking with one girl, Abby. In fact, she featured in a small video that was done in conjunction with the Adventist Review. And a wonderful girl, incredibly tenacious, and she grasps this program
like it was a lifeline, and she's worked hard through it. She's getting educated. She uses her fair trade salary to now live independently with her two little children. She'd had this incredible, miserable life, and now she feels like she's empowered. And I remember talking to her, and she had this big smile on her face about how wonderful it was to now know God. And she's learning new things from the Bible about how to care for her children, herself. And so these are some of the measurements that we'll use as well. It's not just financial metrics, but they are important. It is a business we've got to run.
So it's wonderful to know that you're actually changing lives, not just for now, but you're teaching them about Jesus.
Absolutely.
Okay, yeah. Wonderful. Now, there's actually a testimony that we can hear that gives us some insight on a personal level about what's happening. Should we call Esther out?
Yeah, yeah. Just before we do, it's probably appropriate that I tell you and everybody else that the value that this program is adding means that we have to move to more of an international flavor. Mm-hmm. So we're going to dump the Australia thing, and we are launching our new brand, which is Venture Global Fund, and it adds the real international dynamic to the program that we're running. So next ASI, look out for us with a new name.
Okay.
But I think we should hear from Esther, because she's got the real story.
Okay. Come, Esther.
My name is Esther. When I was 19, I was trafficked and forced into prostitution from the Philippines to Japan by the Japanese Yakuza. I was tricked, I was kicked, I was raped. They did all sorts of things to me. I grew up in a slums of Davao City, Philippines. Every day, it was just, you know, we struggle for food. My parents are animistic, they worship the spirits, and one day, my dad, I was converted to Protestant, and since then, my parents were fighting. And it got so bad that they got separated. So my siblings and I have five other siblings, was put into a place away from our home, and just by ourselves, without our mom, and I had to look after them. And my dad just only come on a weekend to give us some food and supplies. And during this time, my dad molested me every time he come over. I couldn't tell anyone. I was so scared because he used to beat us up. And it got so bad that my siblings and I were put into different homes so that we can just have food to eat and shelter over our head. And we were treated like slaves. And we had no communication with each other. At that time, I was only 12, and our youngest was only 2. So when I was 18, I got this opportunity to work in Manila. That's three days by ship. And I worked in return for my college. But I was also exploited. They didn't pay me. They didn't do what they promised. So I left that workplace. But then I become homeless. And that was when I applied to work in Japan. So I was held captive in Japan, and for a few months I managed to escape, and I got deported back to the Philippines. A few years have passed. God has blessed me because I was blessed. I went to Australia to live and start a new life. I studied hard, and I was able to finish my studies in accounting, and I have my own business, and I've been so blessed. And I thought I was successful because I now had my dream come true. I had my own career. But then there was something missing in my life. One day, one of my clients, I went to their home office, and they shared Jesus with me, and I asked if I could do some Bible studies, because when I was a kid, I heard about Jesus. And so I became, so after our studies, I found out that they were Seventh-day Adventists, and I thought, oh, I'll just do Bible studies because it's just so weird to go to church on a Saturday. But then in 2010, I was baptized in Salisbury Church in Brisbane, Australia. And that year, we had a family reunion, and I talked to my dad, and I said, Dad, I forgive you for what you did to me. It was difficult for me, but I asked God to help me to say these things to my dad, because I hated him all my life. I didn't feel the love of a father, but I thank God that I didn't realize that he actually looked after me, and you know, he watched over me all those times, all those things that had happened in my life. And so when I, after that time, I felt this inner peace and freedom. I thought God, at that time, I thought God has abandoned me, you know. But he is amazing with what he's done in my life, you know. So now I advocate for helping all the oppressed, the people who are the children and women who have been trafficked. Did you know that there are about over 3,500 people, mostly women and children, that have been trafficked every day? So please help and pray. We, as Christians, we have to do something. I thank you for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to David and his wife, Esther, for being willing to share their story and their passion to reach others. We've just heard today that there are thousands that are being reached through public evangelism, through the use of tools like the New Beginnings, and that they're being housed in a facility where they can be nurtured as Christians through the One Day Church. We know that thousands are being reached in prison cells through ministries like Binding Broken Hearts. We know that thousands are being reached because they may be on their computers and praying and asking God, send somebody here with the truth. And so call porters, students, are knocking on doors, not realizing that they are the answer to those individuals' prayers. What can we do? What will it now take for us to be able to uplift their hands so that they can enlarge their territory? What will it take for us to be able to help them enhance their capacity? What will it take for us to be able to help them so that they can be encouraged for their faithful support and to continue the efforts of what they're trying to accomplish in response to the call that God has given them? These are just a few of the stories. You've heard them all week. Some of the projects, we've got 38 that of many projects and ministries that are seeking to respond to the call that God has given them to reach others for Jesus. But we've only shared with you just a handful so that we can try and understand the need that's there and how we might be able to provide that support. I looked up the word sacrifice, and one of the definitions said, surrendering a possession as an offering to God. God has blessed us for the purpose of surrendering back to Him in an offering to be able to finish His work so He can come home, so that we can go home and He can come and get us. But what will it take? I asked you last night if you would please pray and ask the Holy Spirit for guidance as to what needs to be done today from your heart and from the blessings that God has given you. I also asked you to pray a prayer that I often pray. Lord, give me the courage to trust you and to obey your leading. At this time, I want to make sure that everyone has your offering envelope. If you have that, you can begin to complete that. For those of you who might have your phone, a mobile device, you can actually go to the website, asiministries.org, and click on the red button, Donate Now. So two very easy ways to register your donation or your pledge and to respond to the Holy Spirit as he has led you. I am hopeful that the questions that we've given to you to ponder throughout this week, what can we do to enlarge one's territory? What can we do to enhance their capacity? And what can we do to encourage their faithful continuance and effort to reach others for Jesus? That those questions will be answered in such a powerful and affirmative way that it will be recognized by the offering that will be taken up today. So as you complete your envelope or do your donation on your mobile device, I would like to pray before the offering is lifted. Father in heaven, it is our privilege to work with you for the saving of souls. We have been inspired by the stories that we've heard. We have been in awe of the passion and the sacrifice made by so many that are in ministry for you. Lord, you've given us blessings. You've given us comfort. You've given us the knowledge of your love and your soon coming. We want to make sure that the millions that are out there that don't know about you, that they have the opportunity to learn about your love and that you're coming soon to take us all home. Lord, help us that we might be able to set aside any sense of selfishness, feeling like we might need to hold on to anything. Help us to remember that you take care of us, you provide for us, and give us the courage to respond to the leading of your Holy Spirit and to provide the means necessary for these projects to accomplish their call because they've been chosen and they have committed themselves to your service. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, let's try this one.
Again. Glory, joy, and
ABN viewers who are joining us here at the ASI convention in Phoenix, Arizona. I know there are many of you from South Dakota,
to Florida, to Tennessee, to Michigan, to California, and even Colorado who are not able to be with us this year that are regular attendees. I want to give special greetings to you and all the rest of you who may be watching and have just tuned in today. There's been an incredible spiritual blessing here at our convention. And just now, you've heard the presentations about our ASI offering. And we know that many of you out there may want to join us here that are assembled in the Phoenix Convention Center and participate in this offering that's coming in right now. If you look behind me, you'll see the people taking that offering up. If you would like to participate in this offering, we want to tell you how to do that. There's an address that's coming up on the screen just now for our ASI office in Silver Spring, Maryland. Also, our website. The website, asiministries.org/donate. If you go on your website to that address right now, there's a big red button there that says donate. You can click on that, and you can be a part of this great offering that's going to be reaching thousands of people around the world with various resources and various services. I want to thank you all for joining in the ASI spirit that we are sensing here. Continue to enjoy the beauty of the Glendale Church Choir that's singing right now as we continue our worship service. God bless you and happy Sabbath.
Jesus shines brighter. Jesus shines
Happy Sabbath, ASI. It is my privilege to be able on behalf of ASI, ASI Missions, Inc., and the ASI family, to give a small token of our appreciation for the work of Joan and Harold Lance. You know, I went back and asked Harold and Joan when they first joined ASI. Now, I remember when I was in high school singing in a choir, and he was in the audience of ASI. And it's been over, what'd you say, 41 years.
You know, there are few people that have had as large an impact on ASI and what you see today as Harold and Joan Lance. I remember the first time I went to an ASI convention, which is a long time ago in 1983, Harold was the president of ASI. I want you to know that Harold has served
two different terms, not consecutive, but two different terms as president of the full organization. The last 18 years, he has served as the president and chairman of ASI Missions, Inc., which is a very critically important part of ASI that is a separate organization under the board of ASI. But, you know, way beyond those titles, Harold and Joan, I think if you were to look back at a picture, if we were able to put a picture up on the screen of all the things that have been going on, you would see Harold trekking through one of the Central African countries with a big pack on his back, going to one of the outpost centers to help make things happen. You would have seen him on an airplane, that large frame of his crunched in with Denzel in a little time, and almost crashing one time on a remote airstrip someplace.
Right. Yes.
You would have seen him sitting in board meetings in India, in Europe, in Central Europe, in South America, in Asia, mm-hmm. very involved in the supporting ministries here of North America, but someone who has passionately given what he has been given from God to the service of his fellow man through the ASI organization. And Harold, you and Joan are a special treasure to us. Now, I just want to let you all know that even though he is retiring as the president and chairman of ASI Missions, Inc., we are not letting him off the hook.
No, we are not.
Okay. Harold is still going to be a member of the board and executive committee of ASI Missions, Inc., so we will continue to have his expertise, his insight, and his heaven-born wisdom. Now, one of the things that's going to happen, and one of the things that is going through my mind as I was thinking about this moment, Harold is an attorney, as you may know, if you've seen him up here before. Harold spent, 32 years, Harold, in practice?
Right.
32 years. 32 years in practice. But how many years have you been full-time as a volunteer in ASI?
27.
27. So it's almost like a second career complete. Mm-hmm. But which one of those two would be more rewarding to you?
Hey, it's been a blessing of God to be, to have the privilege to be involved in ASI and the supporting ministry work that we've had.
Well, one of the things that I know for sure is that if you were able to look at all of the successful, incredibly successful projects that have Harold's fingerprints on them, those are things that will go on all the way until the Lord comes. I know that for a fact. He has had his hands and has guided and carefully crafted things for us and kept all of us kind of on track in many, many times. And Harold and Joan, we just don't know how to thank you. But we know the angels of heaven are watching and God is smiling right now as we are attempting in our best way to give you the honor that we believe you deserve.
I think that our desire is that, like Paul, when his retirement party was taking place in the jail, he said, I have fought the fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And then he used a lawyer word, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, but not for me only, but for all who believe in his coming. And that's what we think.
And that all who believe in his coming are all of us who are here today and all of those who are watching by 3ABN right now around the world. We thank you, Harold, for what you do and continue to do, and I know will continue to do, but thank you so much.
Harold, just as a small token of our appreciation, we wanted to give you a globe. And this globe is to represent just a small portion of what you've had an impact around the world with the ministries and the ministry that you all have done. And we just want you to know from the deep of our hearts how much we appreciate you. And only until eternity will we know the full impact of what you have done for the Lord's work. Thank you.
Now Denzel, there's something I just got to point out. There's a little thing here. I want you to know that this, for those of you who are watching, this globe is upside down. And, you know, wasn't it talking about the world being turned upside down?
Yes.
So I think that was symbolic. I think the world is in the process of being turned upside down, Harold. So we know you've been a big part of that.
Amen. Thank you.
Oh, that's lovely.
Happy Sabbath, ASI. And to everyone who is watching or listening, this is a beautiful Sabbath day, and we serve a covenant-keeping God, do we not? And you know what? every time God made a covenant, he had a sign. For example, with Noah, he had the sign of the rainbow. You know what the sign of the covenant of grace is? The Sabbath. Exodus 31:13, God said, this is a sign that he's the one who's going to sanctify us. Well, it is my privilege today to introduce our speaker for divine worship, John Bradshaw. And John began his professional career in broadcasting as a disc jockey in his home country of New Zealand. There he worked for some of the top radio stations, but God called him out of that and into full-time evangelism. And this gentleman, in two decades of ministry, has conducted 100 evangelistic series. Then he became a pastor at Lexington, Kentucky, and also at College Park, Washington. But in 2011, God chose him to be the fourth speaker director for It Is Written. And one thing that I really appreciate that John has instituted since he's been there is his little one-minute devotional for busy people. And if you go to the website, every day there's a new devotional called Every Word. John is an author, he's a husband, he's a father, but most of all, he is a committed child of God and a manservant of God. And today his message is going to be Committed is the title. And the scripture reading is 1 Thessalonians 5:24 that says, he who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. The next voice you hear after our special song will be John Bradshaw, speaker and director of It Is Written.
Join us in singing this beautiful hymn arrangement of Crown Hymn with Many Crowns.
Thank you. Well, that was beautiful. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Good morning, everyone. I know it's not morning, but I've learned long ago never begin by saying good afternoon, because you lost them already. So, it's a good morning, everyone. It's a blessing to be here at ASI, isn't it? That was tepid. That was kind of tepid. It's a blessing to be here at ASI, isn't it? Yeah. Amen. It is. And I trust you have been inspired and motivated and encouraged and moved and blessed even beyond that which you were expecting. God is good. What do you say? Yeah. God is good. We are privileged to be here. I just want to point out something. Somebody contacted me and was concerned that I was embracing polygamy. The biography in the little bio in the program said that John is married to Melissa and the father of two children. You know, I hardly know what to say. I'm just grateful that God's people are open-minded. I'm also a little bothered that evidently many other people read that and simply thought, okay. I'm a little worried about you today. Anyway, we are here to pray and open up God's word. Let's do that in that order. Would you bow your head with me as we pray? Our Father and our God, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We are grateful. We are blessed far beyond our deservingness. And we are thankful today that you have carved out a little time for us to gather here together and look towards your face and look into your word. And we pray that we would encounter your spirit and be moved. Lord, we gather together, warts and all, as your people. Thank you for visiting us and tabernacling with us this day. I ask that the limitations of fallen humanity would not prevent your spirit from doing a great work over these next few minutes. Speak and be heard. We pray in Jesus' name. Please say with me, amen. They had come many years before from Eastern Polynesia. Peace had become the cornerstone of their culture. In the 16th century, a tribal leader named Nunuku heard the sound of young men fighting. He went to that place and urged them to stop. He appealed to the young men and the old men, the young women and the not-so-young women, to fight no more. He said, "We must not be a warring people." From then on, if there was conflict between the men, that conflict could only be settled at harshest by using what was known as a tupurari, a long stick no thicker than a man's thumb. They could use that as a weapon. At the first sight of blood, the conflict ended. He who drew the blood was declared the victor, and they went right on. That was as bad as it got. In an era of war and intertribal conflict, these people would not fight. They were committed to Nunuku's law. But in 1835, everything changed for the peaceful Moriori of Rekohu, Chatham Island. 900 Maori from the Ngati Tama and Ngati Mutunga tribes arrived aboard a British sailing ship. They came from the mainland 500 miles away. They arrived seasick, tired. They arrived hungry, worn out. And so the kind-hearted locals fed them and nursed them and invited them to stay and share their provisions if they would like. But their courtesy was not to be kindly repaid. These were not visitors. They were invaders. The peaceful Moriori had a decision to make. What would they do? To not fight back would be to sign their own death warrant. They would be killed, or they would be enslaved, and the practice of the invaders was to cannibalize their victims. This was a crisis, and there was no way it could end well. The young men urged that they fight 2,000 locals against 900 invaders. This could be done. But the older men looked at it from a different perspective. They advised the people should stay true to who they were. These were a people who, at their core, you might say, in their DNA, were committed to nonviolence. They decided they would not fight back because of who they were. It's one thing to jeopardize your existence to save the life of another person, to advance your people, to achieve independence, to throw off tyranny. But were the Moriori really prepared to die for an ideal? But wait, this was more than an ideal. Nonviolence was bound up with their identity, inextricably bound up. They had to be true to their core values, true to their principles, true to who they were. Why? Because they were committed, so much so that within about two decades, that entire people group had been wiped out. They were massacred. The question that guided them was, quite simply, who are we? What do we stand for as a people? To answer that question would lead them to both greatness and oblivion. And hindsight suggests that the two cannot be separated. That question, who are we? What are we made of? What do we stand for as a people? Answer that question and it will define you. Answer that question and you have found your cynosure. You have found your polaris. The theme of this year's gathering at ASI speaks to that question. Who are we? What are we made of? What do we stand for as a people? Called, chosen, committed. We have been called, the Bible tells us that, 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 9, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ. Every person alive has been called by God. Jesus died for whosoever. Paul told Timothy, God has saved us and called us with a holy calling. There is no denying that you have been called, called by God. When you are not so sure of your place in this world, not sure of your worth in the big picture, not sure the direction of your life, where it should go, where it might lead you, remember, you have been called by God. God has a plan for you. God has a work for you. God has a purpose for you. You have been called. Would you say amen today? We have been chosen. According to Peter, we are a chosen generation. Jesus said in John 15, I have chosen you. So that is settled. Not chosen to represent your country at the Olympics. Not chosen for elected office. Chosen, handpicked by God to be His and everything that entails. It is no accident that you are here today. God wants you to be confident that He has chosen you. There's nothing more certain. Called you, selected you, called for sure, chosen undoubtedly, committed Now there's a question. Are we committed? We could answer that by saying, of course we are. We are all committed to something. There's no doubt. But to what are we committed? God calls us to commitment. Jesus told one man that the greatest commandment was to love God with your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. Cultural Christianity is not Christianity at all. It is too late in the history of this world for God's people to be playing games. There are myriad places in the Bible where we could see commitment demonstrated, but I would like to lead you down a road less traveled today. Please turn with me in your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 35. We will gallop through a short passage in Jeremiah chapter 35. We'll start in verse 1. Turn there. Jeremiah 35, verse 1. The Bible says, "The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, saying," listen, "go to the house of the Rechabites, speak to them, and bring them into the house of the Lord, into one of the chambers, and give them wine to drink." Now this was God speaking through his prophet. Bring them into a room in the temple and have them drink wine. So Jeremiah says later in the passage, "I brought them into the house of the Lord, into the chamber of the sons of Hanan, the son of Igdaliah. Then I set before the sons of the house of the Rechabites bowls full of wine and cups. And I said to them, drink wine." Now it's true, he did not say, "God commands you to drink wine." But still, this was the prophet, and they knew that that was so. Now let me just take a time out here and speak to something. We know full well that there are voices, loud voices, some of them, and not all on the periphery, who love to denigrate the prophetic message given by God to his people. Friend of God, we are closing in on the return of Christ. We cannot afford to be soft on the gift of prophecy. What do you say? We cannot. This is no time to be undermining, even passively, something that was only God's idea anyway. Cavilling and cynicism about what we believe should be entertained like you would entertain cancer. The truth is too precious for us to surrender it now. Amen. And so the Rechabites answer. They said, "We will drink no wine, no wine. For Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, commanded us, saying, you shall drink no wine, nor your sons forever." They went on to say, "Thus we have obeyed the voice of Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, in all that he charged us, to drink no wine in all of our days. Jeremiah, we hear you, we understand you, we get you, but we are not going to do what you say. We might seem contrary, we might come off as uncooperative, but what we want you to know, Jeremiah, is that we are committed." And committed they were. Jeremiah spoke up again and he said, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, go and tell the men of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, will you not receive instruction to obey my words?" If you read on, you find out that God had a problem. Here was his people. He had labored with them. He had pleaded with them. He had chastised them. He had turned them. He had demonstrated his long suffering to them again and again and again. And still, they couldn't find it within themselves to be faithful to the Creator God. And here come the Rechabites. Jeremiah says, "I am the prophet of God, and I am telling you to drink wine." And they look him in the face and they say, "We are just not going to do it." God wanted Israel to understand what commitment looked like. And I wonder if he wants us to know the same thing. They were dedicated. They were committed. Interestingly, they didn't show up in the Bible until that time, and they don't show up again explicitly after that time. That's the only place in the Bible you read about these folks. And they showed up on time to give us a demonstration of commitment. What is it we really stand for today as God's people? Well, we stand for the gospel, especially as it is expressed in the three angels in Revelation chapter 14. We stand for Christ and what he stands for. We are on this earth so that God's work can be done. We stand for reflecting Christ for letting God have his way. They tried to trap Jesus in his words. He pointed them to God always. His life spoke of commitment, and he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Now, God has given us a mandate, friend, a mandate. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We have a transformational message, one that offers to the world hope and wholeness. There is a world to win. All around us are people going down to Christless graves. And as they do so, listen carefully, the clock still ticks. We cannot go on inventing ways of distracting ourselves from the mission of God's church. If ever there was a time for a full court press, that time is now. We are not unaware of the challenges. And we understand that when the Bible spoke of the 10 virgins, it said they were all asleep. We read the message to the church of Laodicea, and you cannot say, that applies to the faction of the church that I'm not a part of. It applies to you, me, the liberals on the left, the cranky conservatives way out on the right. We are all involved in this thing. But it's not possible to be committed to Christ and not be committed to the church he loves. It is not possible to be committed to Christ and not be committed to the souls for which he died. And hasn't God encouraged us again and again that it pays off to be about his business? How many were baptized in Rwanda recently? Tell me. The better part of 100,000. There's only one question to ask. When are we doing it again? How many were baptized the last time your church got involved in soul winning? What are you waiting for? How many lives were touched during the last outreach effort, either by a gospel tract or a hand on the shoulder, either by a smile or a kind deed? Lives were touched, and they are waiting to be touched again. Who knew evangelism was so truly effective? The work of God, evangelism in all of its forms. Can we not agree once and for all that we as God's people are committed to evangelism? We believe in evangelism. We'll stop whispering beside the water cooler about how evangelism doesn't work. We believe in this because God believes in this. And we'll not only believe in it, we'll be involved in sharing Christ with as many as we can. The critics may carp and bicker, but still we hear Nehemiah saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down to you? There has never been a better time to be committed to the work of the church than now. Jesus said 2,000 years ago, the fields are white and they are ready to harvest. We stand on the verge of the greatest ingathering of souls this universe has ever witnessed. If you look at the glass half empty, you might say, what about those big cities where we barely have a presence? But if you have a look at the glass half full, you will say, wait, there is a great work just waiting to be done. And we have it on the authority of the Bible. God will get it done before Jesus comes back. The question is, will you be part of getting it done? God votes for you, not against you. Now, you will remember from high school the periodic table of elements. And being the good science student that you were, you remember that the first element of the table was what?
Hydrogen.
All right, I found me a science student. Then?
Helium.
Then? Hydrogen. Helium. Then what?
Lithium.
Then? Then? Beryllium. No Google now. Hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon, Uzbekistan, Afghanistan, Kyrgyzstan. If you look down to about number 50-something, you'll find something on that table called cesium. And cesium is a fascinating little beast for a number of reasons. One of the reasons is because it has one atom on its valence shell, its outer shell. And that atom spends its time, it is vigilant. It spends its time looking for, what would you call them, molecules? Molecules? Oh, I don't know. You know, I don't trust atoms anyway. They make up everything. Someone will explain it to you. But it gets around this cesium molecule with an extra atom on its valence shell. It looks for molecules, and I hope I'm using the right terminology, that lack their complete complement of electrons. And so if you put cesium near oxygen, and oxygen is looking for another electron, that extra cesium atom, or that one on the valence shell, will leap and boom. If you put it near iodine or bromine or fluorine, you're going to get the same reaction. Now, it's not that cesium is a troublemaker, but wherever it goes, excitement is going to follow because, boom, you're going to have this reaction. Why? Again, it's not looking for trouble. Cesium just does what cesium does. It does what it does because it is what it is. That's all. When God calls you to be His, you'll be a lot like that cesium molecule. You will do what you do because you are what you are. God calls us to ministry. It must be our focus in whatever form God brings to you. We cannot let the devil draw us away from what God wants us to do. We've been commissioned. We got a mandate. Go, therefore. Go. Make disciples. Where? Of all nations. Do what? Baptize them. Teach them all things I have commanded you. When we become Christ's, we are looking for that opportunity. You don't see a lost person and turn and walk away. Something stirs in your heart. You cry out to God, Lord, can you use me here? And when God says, yes, I can, then you are used by God. You are familiar with the quote? It's the opening stanza of the book Acts of the Apostles. Listen, I believe these words and I know you do too. The church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. From the beginning, it has been God's plan that through His church shall be reflected to the world His fullness and His sufficiency. The members of the church, those whom He has called out of darkness into His marvelous light, those He has called are to show forth His glory. The church is the repository of the riches of the grace of Christ, and through the church will eventually be made manifest even to the principalities and powers in heavenly places, the final and full display of the love of God. We have been called. God calls us to commitment. What does it look like? It looks like the Moriori on Rekohu, Chatham Island, 500 miles from the South Island of New Zealand. It looks like a woman breaking an alabaster box of ointment. She gave Jesus the best she had. It looks like a widow putting two mites in the offering plate. She gave everything she had. It looks like that little widow lady giving the last measure of oil she had to the prophet. It looks like Isaiah saying, here am I, send me. It sounds like Jacob saying, I will not let you go except you bless me. It looks like Samson saying, Lord, give me strength just one more time. It looks like David running towards Goliath. It looks like people letting God work in them, that God's work is done and His mission is accomplished. Noah built an ark. Elijah built an altar. Moses built a sanctuary. Nehemiah built a wall. They were committed to God, and so they stood up, they stepped up, and they lit up their corner of the universe with a manifestation of God's character, a demonstration of what commitment to God looks like. We are called. We have been chosen. The question is, are we committed? We must be committed. A young missionary from New Zealand, his name was Len Barnard, went to Papua New Guinea. They said, Len, don't go down into those valleys. The cannibals will eat you. He went anyway. He carried his Bible in one hand, a bag of medicine in the other. The Spirit of God filled his heart. 50, 60 years later, you can go back to those same villages, beautiful villages filled with God's people. Go to church on Sunday. It'll be empty, but up front will be the offering plate, still with the offering from yesterday. The church has no windows and no doors. No one's going to steal that, because God has got into those hearts, changed those lives. These are people who are committed, because one man's commitment drove him to jeopardize his own safety and his own life. A Scots Protestant ministry named John Patton determined to share Christ in what was then the New Hebrides in the South Pacific. A Mr. Dixon said, "The cannibals, you will be eaten by the cannibals." Patton said, "Mr. Dixon, you are now advanced in years. You will soon be laid in the grave and eaten by worms." If I can live and die serving and honoring Jesus, it will make no difference to me whether I'm eaten by cannibals or by worms. In the resurrection, my body will rise as fair as yours in the likeness of our Redeemer. We were filming for It Is Written recently in Scotland, and I stood at the place where the martyr George Wishart was hanged and burned by the scoundrel Archbishop Cardinal Beaton. Here's what's interesting. 18 years before, Patrick Hamilton had been burned, 250 yards away. Wishart knew that. He knew that going back to Scotland and preaching Protestantism would have him reduced to a pile of ashes. What did he do? He went anyway. He could do no other. Christ had him. What drives a person to do that? Dr. Martin Luther King was standing on the platform at Mason Temple. He knew about the threats on his life. He knew that his plane, the one in which he flew to Memphis, had been guarded that night before. Otherwise, somebody might have taken occasion to kill him. And yet he stood, and yet he spoke. He said, "I just want to do God's will. He's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord." The next day, the unthinkable happened. Room 306 of the Lorraine Motel became part of the legend of this nation's history. What drives a person to make such a sacrifice? No, wait, wrong question. It's not a sacrifice. It's what you do when you believe with all of your heart. God says go, you go. God says share, you share. God says be there, you say, "Lord, I am there because I am committed to Christ." But wait, we are faulty people here. Flawed, we are flawed. Yes, you are, I'll tell you. Inadequate, broken. How is it then that God can get his work done? And the minute, actually, if you're listening carefully, you might be saying all of this call to commitment sounds like a call to righteousness by works. It is the opposite. A call to commitment can only be a call to righteousness by faith, because understood correctly, commitment is not something we can give to God. Commitment is something Christ performs in us when Jesus has our heart. You know as well as I do, from bitter experience, that our promises are like ropes of sand. How can we be committed to this God? You are weak. God says, "My strength is made perfect in weakness." You are battling temptation, and God says, "I will make a way of escape." You are corrupt, and God says, "A new heart will I put within you." God will do what needs to be done. We read in the Bible, "Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it." God had a plan. Jonah ran. God went after him. The prodigal son left home, and the Spirit of God followed him to a pigsty. Three men were out there on the plain of Dura, and because they prayed, the Holy Spirit locked their knee joints, and they were unable and unwilling to bow down. Daniel, knowing that his life was on the line, prayed to God anyway. They threw him in the lion's den, and God was there with him. Daniel understood, "He who has begun a good work in you is faithful to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." There is no need for discouragement here. God takes responsibility for the work in you and in the church. How do we reach the 1040 window? How do you reach your patients or your clients? How can a small church minister effectively in its community? How do we share Jesus with the massive populations who barely have ever heard his name? Let me tell you something the Bible says. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world. God is committed to his church. He stands at the head of the work. Somebody spoke to Jesus one day and said, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus said, "I am willing." Jesus says to the church today, "I am willing." Jesus says to the church today, "I want to." Jesus says to the church today, "I will get it done in your life if you'll let me, and in the mission and in the ministry of the church." Friend, I believe in this church. I believe that weak and enfeebled though it is still the one object upon this earth upon which Christ bestows in a special sense his supreme regard. This is no time for division. This is a time for unity. We may still disagree about this, that, or the other, but we must agree on that on which we must agree. Christ is the head of this church, and there is nothing more important than reaching the lost, doing our Father's business, and occupying until he comes. And let me tell you something. If you think your little commitment might not make much difference, I want you to think back to my Moriori friends. They were massacred, wiped out, but somebody named Tefiti Orongomai learned of their commitment and led the village of Parihaka in nonviolent resistance against the white colonialists. Now, here's what you might find interesting. A man named Mohandas Gandhi knew about Tefiti Orongomai and his stand, his nonviolent resistance. Take that one step further. Dr. Martin Luther King was inspired by the example of Gandhi. Now, you will excuse me if you feel like I'm stretching a little bit, but I can stretch all I want because I have the microphone. And listen, the Moriori are a people you've never heard of, and yet it may well be that their example in standing for who they were and doing what they knew to be right profoundly influenced the civil rights movement in this country. To that I say, praise the Lord. The producers of Hacksaw Ridge, the Desmond Doss movie, they were asked, "Why did you not do it accurately?" What? You have Desmond Doss dragging people to safety when he dragged the first two and carried the rest. They said, "Well, that's right, but if we did it like that, no one would believe we were telling the truth." Desmond Doss dragged them, the first two carried the next 73. And every time he lowered one down that cliff, his prayer was, "Lord, give me one more. Lord, give me one more. Lord, give me one more," 74 times. The government actually believes 99 times. Doss said 50, the government said 100, so they split the difference. That's why you hear the number 75. 74 times he prayed that prayer. "Lord, give me one more." Friends, we are out here in the heat of battle. There are the wounded out on the battlefield. Our prayer has to be, "Lord, give me one more. Lord, give us one more. Lord, raise us up to preach again, to prophesy again, to proclaim again, to witness again, to testify again. Lord, give me one more." Even though commitment to mission might be unfashionable, to back off is unthinkable, distraction is unacceptable, misplacing our priorities is unconscionable. To see more people lost would be unbearable. Arguments against mission are untenable. Ignoring the world's great need, unacceptable. Now, you might be uncomfortable, led to places that are undesirable, immersed in cultures that are unpalatable, challenged by the unforeseeable, prodded by the unpredictable. But your experience with Christ will be unforgettable. God's leading will be unmistakable. We must be undividable, our faith unshakable, our resolve unbendable, believing that not one of God's people is unusable. The church will be unrecognizable. God's people will be unstoppable because his spirit is uncontainable. His power to do this work is unarguable. We will see God work in us, through us, around us, and we will say, unbelievable. Jesus is coming back soon. There's time to win one more. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness to all nations. The end will come. Why? Because God is committed. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we cannot tell you how much we love you. We want to love you more. And you must use us. We cannot go from here less effective than when we arrived at this convention. We cannot go from here less committed than when we drove into town. We cannot be the same. Lord, it's time to raise up your people, your church. It's time. We want to see Jesus come soon. Here we are. Help us, Lord, to reach one more is our prayer. In Jesus' name, please say, amen and amen.
Temptation casts o'er me.